Hi, I'm Andy Walker. I'm a grape breeder and geneticist here at UC Davis, and we're standing in the campus vineyards right now in my breeding blocks, amongst a few of the advanced selections that are ready to be distributed through the nursery industry. So the beginning of this process, the breeding process, is the identification of resistant plant material. And we were able to find resistant plants from the southwestern United States and from northern Mexico, highly resistant to Pierce disease, that we could breed and cross with vinifera cultivars, and therefore have at first generation something that's 50% wild species and 50% vinifera, high quality vinifera. And each generation then we cross back to high quality vinifera, increasing the percentage of the vinifera in the backgrounds. But the key is finding the resistance in the first place. The next major step in this process is the ability to mark and map and follow these resistance genes through generations. Starting about the 88%, so two generations prior to this, we began field testing these plants. And the first field tests were done in the Behringer vineyards in Yountville, where they've had a stretch of property along the Napa River levees that have chronically infected with Pierce's disease. So it was a great spot. And they were very willing and very kindly allowed us to inoculate those plants too. So we didn't wait for natural inoculations. We mechanically inoculated all those plants repeatedly. So we've been able to watch and see expression and see which plants sort of fell apart, which ones didn't. Of course, the ones we're advancing didn't and did quite well. We've grown them in several other locations in Napa as well, and some in Healdsburg. There's testings down in Southern California, and a bunch of new trials have gone in the last few years all over the state and also across other states. The first efforts there were in Texas, where Jim Comas has been a very good collaborator, again at the earlier generations, not at the advanced generations, to really test these things in what he was considering to be the most severe spots. And they're very excited about them down there. I've been down giving several tastings over the years in those areas. We have them being tested in Georgia, in Alabama. Again, it's to test the different strains in those spots, the different vectors, the different environments, all those things to see whether or not resistance holds up in the same way. And so far, it looks fine. We have not sent the most advanced material there yet, so we're looking at the same resistance in multiple generations, and those earlier generations have a relatively low percentage of vinifera. The later generations we're releasing, again, have this 97% very high level of vinifera for quality. So they haven't really got a chance to look at the highest quality materials yet, although they will soon, but they've been really test points to see how that resistance functions in a different environment, and we've been very happy with the way it's performed so far. These vines are the product of many years of development. This last cross here was made in 2009. These vines have been tested frequently and repeatedly in terms of their resistance to Pierce's disease, and they've been evaluated for wine quality frequently and assessed it by professionals and by other researchers as well. And now they've gone through the Foundation Plant Services and they're ready for commercial release. In fact, they've been on pre-release, five of these selections on pre-release to nurseries now. For the last couple of years, they're bulking them up for commercial sales, which we expect will be first in the spring of 2020 and with increasing numbers as time goes by. That last step in the process, getting the nurseries convinced that they should be accepting these materials and developing them, bulking them up for commercial sales, is tricky. They have to they're taking a risk. They don't know what the demand will be, and they've got to plant a large number of vines before they can generate commercial material at reasonable rates and sizes. We originally thought that these vines would be primarily used for blending. So there's a 75% blending restriction for varietal labeling of wines, and we thought, well, we could use these grapes along riparian corridors where Pierce disease is quite severe, and we could go back and take that fruit and blend it in with the main fruit in the body of the area, so therefore you'd have very productive PD-ridden areas. But we're now confident that these wines can compete on their own as well, and some of the growers we've had taste these things are quite interested and excited about them too from a varietal wine perspective, where we may actually be naming these things and marketing them as an independent wine variety too, which would greatly enhance their marketability probably over time. One of the largest supporters we've had so far is Camus Vineyards. Chuck Wagner there has been very, very positive in his response to them and really wanting to see these utilized. He's grown quite a few of them in Napa. We've made our first commercial scale wines with him. All the rest of our wines have been at the five plus gallon level, not very large scale wines, difficult to make, hard to evaluate sometimes, but of course necessary if we're testing hundreds of these selections as we go through. So he's really taken a few and brought them up to 1,000 vine level and made commercial scale wines, which also ranked and were rated very highly last year. successful. And now we've been able to combine very high quality wine characteristics with that very high quality, very high resistance level from these different backgrounds.